Thank you. Welcome to the Church of Holy Trinity, Guildwood. We are so glad that you can be with us in person and online. If this is your first time with us, you are especially welcome. When we come together online and in person, we are the body of Christ.
Today, we honor and acknowledge that this land and locality are in the historical traditional lands of the indigenous peoples of what we call Turtle Island and what is commonly called North America. We acknowledge the leadership of indigenous elders who continue to teach us about what it means to live in a balanced and good way with creation. May our time of worship together be blessed as we give respect to the first peoples of this land and seek to live in right relationships with ourselves, Creator, and one another. We pray that the Spirit will lead us into all truth, into repentance for the wrongs of the past, and into true reconciliation with our Indigenous brothers and sisters, that we may be partners in healing and peace, to the glory and thanksgiving of God, our Creator.
Our liturgy begins on page 3 in the bulletin. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
May his grace and peace be with you.
May he fill our hearts with joy.
As we remain standing, let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, the strength of those who believe and the hope of those who doubt, may we who have not seen have faith and receive the fullness of Christ's blessing, who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated for the proclamation of the word.
A reading from the book of Acts. When Peter saw it, he addressed the people. You Israelites, why do you wonder at this, or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the Holy and Righteous One, and asked to have a murderer given to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know, and the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out. Listen for the leading of the Spirit. Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness, for sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. Listen for the leading of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
The Lord be with you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus himself stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While they were in joy, they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Please be seated. I speak to you in the name of the most blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, life has many joys. As I joined some of the ladies at 8 o'clock, after the 8 o'clock service for coffee, all of us had a smile as the sun came out. Just the sun brings a little bit of joy. Or perhaps it was your morning cup of coffee, or for me these days, I wake up and Sophie comes and gives a little purr at my feet, and I go, "Oh, the day's off to a good start." So life has many joys, but also sorrows. We all experience times of confusion, distress, failure and loss, broken relationships, sickness, and maybe the death of a loved one or eventually our own. At those times, we might ask, "What's happening? Why me? Does life have a purpose, a meaning? Does God exist?" This Sunday, we're back again with the disciples in the upper room. It's Easter evening, so it's Easter day only in the evening. The last two Sundays, we've been hearing the Easter story from the Apostle John, who was actually there as a live witness. Now Luke shares his testimony. For the disciples, life has been a roller coaster. They were there for the honeymoon with Jesus. Jesus was like a media star. Wherever he went, the crowds came. The crowds loved him. You remember, he had had this spontaneous parade erupt as he came into Jerusalem. He was a wise man. He preached with power and passion. He was a teacher and a healer. People with great illnesses, they encountered Jesus and were healed. The disciples had bet the farm. What's that, the expression? They had bet everything that he was the one. Except now he's crucified, dead. Jesus proving to be no match for the military power of Rome or the religious and political establishment. The disciples are so scared that they've run. They've run and fled. They're terrified. I mean, if Jesus is crucified, maybe the Roman soldiers or the police of the Sanhedrin will be getting them next. They're scared. They're anxious. They're dispirited, confused. Jesus wasn't the one they thought he was. He is certainly not the Messiah. When you go and walk from Galilee to Jerusalem, you'll find, I was quite surprised the first time I was in the Holy Land, all the caves where many rebels had hid. So Jesus has now just become another one of, and I mean this literally, the thousands upon thousands that Rome has crucified. I remember I'm about 30 and I'm living overseas, and I had a particular idea of how the world worked and was put together, and I had put all my eggs in that Easter basket. One of the most painful periods of my life was when that basket hit the ground and all the eggs broke. And I had to kind of reimagine, re-understand life from the bottom up again. That's about the age these disciples are, early 30s. And they had a particular understanding of how it was all going to come to glory in Jesus, and that entire basket of Easter eggs is smashed, lying in ruins on the ground. How misguided they were to depend on Jesus. But now all of a sudden, two of their fellow disciples have burst into the room to say they met Jesus today on the road to Emmaus. And even earlier that day, Mary, and there had been other crazy reports that they had seen Jesus. It's too much. It's crazy making. They feel like their heads are about to burst. Who knows what to think? And in the midst of all this confusion comes Jesus. Peace be with you. At first they wonder if they're having like a group hallucination. The text says they were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see." The hands that had broken bread and blessed, touched, and healed are wounded now. The feet that had walked hundreds of miles to carry the good news to the rich and to the poor, the feet that Mary had anointed with costly perfume, are wounded now. Wounded now with ugliness and bruises, holes, angry holes. As one of my favorite preachers, Barbara Brown Taylor, observes, "It was important for the disciples to look because they hadn't done it before. Earlier, when they had figured out what was coming to those beloved hands and feet, they had fled, hiding themselves away where they could not see the bleeding or hear the pounding of the hammers. Look," Jesus said to them afterwards, "when the danger was past, you can look now." He wanted them to know he had gone through the danger, not around it. Some of us wish he had come back all cleaned up and tidy. But he did not. He he came back with wounded hands and wounded feet. Signs of God's real power over ugliness and evil. Signs of God's real love and forgiveness, even though deserted and betrayed. The resurrection is not just about our beliefs and what we believe, but also about our fears. Think about it. Imagine you had somebody very close to you, and you had, in their moment of greatest need, not only deserted them, but betrayed them. Oh, that friend of mine? No, don't even know them. They're a stranger. Never heard of their name. And now the ugly business is over, so try to forget about it. Move on. But suddenly your friend is back. And why is he back? Your friend is back because they have God's power. Power greater than death. Maybe they're going to get back on you and revenge. Maybe they're going to punish you for being such a low life. Except Jesus doesn't come to punish. Jesus comes to heal, to restore, to bring life and peace. That is the gift of Christ. Well, accepting God's gift of forgiveness and then sharing it, passing it on, forgiving others is at the heart of being a Christian, because that's who God is, love and forgiveness. And that's what Jesus incarnates. What is the prayer you say every day? God, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. God, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. In a moment, we're going to be commissioning leaders into this life of love and forgiveness. One of our beloved leaders, Rowan Williams, former Archbishop of Canterbury, in his book, Resurrection, Interpreting the Easter Gospel, writes, "The resurrection stories seem to be exploring aspects of how the risenness of Jesus has to do with the sense of absolution by God, how the resurrection creates forgiven persons whose relationship with God and derivatively with each other is transformed. They are stories that belong in a community which identifies itself and understands itself as forgiven and traces its establishment as that sort of community to that Easter event." That's the good news. God is in the forgiving business, in reconciling all things, in bringing things together in love. And where God reigns, where God is in charge, there is always reconciliation. That's the sign that God is present. And then what's left to us is, how do we want to respond? And that's why at Easter we renew our baptismal vows to say yes to love, yes to forgiveness, yes to reconciling. At the end, our text today said, "Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, 'Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things.'" So, does life have meaning and purpose? The good news of Easter is an emphatic yes. As the Apostle John said in today's reading, you are a child of God. John says, "See what love the Father has given us, that you should be called children of God, for that is who you are." And being a child of God means a mutual knowing and loving of that most intimate nature, a deep, deep personal relationship. Just like a baby is born, mother places the child on her belly. Such a deep, deep, intimate personal bond. That's the bond God has with you, because you are God's child. And that's the start of the good news. John, if you look at the text today, says, at the end, when all is fully revealed, you will be like him. God's going to look at you and go, is that Shirley or Jesus? Because Shirley is so beautiful, so full of love and forgiveness. I can't tell the difference. Is that Jennifer or Jesus? I look and Jennifer is so glorious and full of light, so full of love and forgiveness. I can't tell the difference. Well, at the very least, the psalmist says, God has got your back. Listen to what the psalmist says. He says, oh God, you set me free when I am hard pressed. Many are saying, oh, that we might see better times. Well, did the psalmist write this yesterday? Because that sure sounds like, oh, that we might see better times. Lift up the light of your countenance upon us, O Lord. You have put gladness in my heart. More than when grain and wine and oil increase, I lie down in peace. At once I fall asleep, for only you, Lord, make me dwell in safety. And when you know who you are, then you know what your purpose is, what you were put on earth to do, to embody and proclaim love and forgiveness, to embody and proclaim peace, repentance, love and forgiveness, starting right here, right now, in this very place, in this church, in your home, in your work, in your neighborhood, and like the dawn, just letting the light, love, and forgiveness increase and spread everywhere. Several years ago, we were blessed to have Rob Voyle do some work with us on forgiveness and visioning. As Rob observed, church is sometimes better at exhorting than teaching. You need to forgive more. You need to pray more. That's why we at Holy Trinity have had over the years many how-to sessions on the basic spiritual disciplines or Christian praxis. We've had the sisters do food for the soul. I've done numerous workshops on Christian meditation and prayer, workshops on forgiveness. I am so excited about the imminent season of spiritual renewal, the first step in the cast the net process, which will be beginning later this year at Holy Trinity and throughout the diocese, because we're fortunate to be part of over 230 sister churches. And we can share our life, our wisdom, our journey in the Spirit as we encourage and accompany each other. There is strength in numbers. Finally, a personal invitation. If you're stuck in your journey to forgiveness, come and chat with me. It's actually in my job description. Although the life of a parish priest can be very busy these days, I always have time for spiritual counsel and conversation. It's what I believe is at the heart of our shared, not my, our shared or common vacation, to be Christ for each other. May the Christ who walks on wounded feet walk with you on the road. May the Christ who serves with wounded hands stretch out your hands to serve. May the Christ who loves with a wounded heart open your heart to love. May you see the face of Christ in everyone you meet, and may everyone you meet see the face of Christ in you. Amen. Those ministry leaders that are present to come forward for commissioning to the church steps. There. Yep. Right down. There we go. There we go. Perfect. And it's Hollywood, so you can kind of face the camera and face me. There we are. Perfect. Okay. Great. Perfect. Well, I am so glad to commission our new leaders. I am a bit brokenhearted because the Hetheringtons are in Portugal, Eva's in Chicago, Brian's in the Dominican Republic, Linda's in Florida, and Mary Beth, Mary Beth will send love and prayers to you. I said, I'll carry your bags for you. I'll go to the Dominican Republic. I'll go to Portugal, really. But no, they said we could stay in Toronto. And there. However, we send love, and I know some of you are online. We send lots of love to you. And as we commission the leaders that are present, we are also remembering you and thank you for your service. And especially as we, and Winnie up here. Come on. We have many who have continued to serve faithfully year after year. You are such a strong foundation. And now the excitement of new leaders coming forth with new gifts and new visions, new hopes and dreams. Would everyone please stand? Brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, we are all baptized by the one Spirit into one body and given gifts for a variety of ministries for the common good. This morning, we ask God to bless the leaders of our parish in the special ministries and responsibilities with which they have been entrusted. You have been called and chosen, elected and appointed to exercise particular ministries in the life of our family, our parish of Holy Trinity Guildwood. Will you, as long as you are engaged in this work, perform it with care to the honor of God and the benefit of the church? And to those of you gathered today, will you uphold and support them in these ministries? Let us pray. Blessed are you, gracious God, our Creator and Redeemer. In every age, you call people to minister in your name. Bless the work of these, your servants, that they may faithfully serve you and show your love in all the world, and so build up your church. Blessed are you, O God, now and forever. Amen. Do not move, please. So, you know, every service we do an offertory. We bring up the bread and the wine and we take a collection. These are but symbols. So really, on this Sunday, you are making the most profound offering. You're offering your time, your talent, and that's what you're putting on the altar to serve God with your gifts. And of course, you understand, everything we have comes from God, so we are just giving back our blessing. But that's the real thing about the offering. It's not about the money, and the bread and wine are the symbols of all that you are, all that you have, and boom, offering it into God's service. God bless you in your ministries. Let us confess our faith, and away you go back to your seats as we'll prepare to say the Nicene Creed. Together we say, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate by the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Sharon, would you lead us in prayer?
Please feel free to sit, kneel, or stand. The risen Christ among us today, and his presence is as real as when he first appeared to the disciples. May we be filled with his peace as we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. The risen Christ opened the minds of the disciples to understand the scriptures. May the church find in scriptures healing, mission, and good news for all. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the church, for the people and clergy of the Anglican Church in Aotearoa, New Zealand, and Polynesia, the clergy and the people of the Diocese of Algoma, the Eglinton Deanery, St. Chad and its monthly supper, Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Linda, our primate, Chris, our National Indigenous Archbishop, and our Metropolitan, Andrew, our Diocesan and Area Bishop. We pray for our church family, for Rebecca Madhu and Joachim Samader, for Barry and Frida Morgan, for Wanda Mordock, for healing with her osteoporosis arthritis. We pray for those celebrating a birthday, for Esther Tilly, for Stephen, our priest. We ask God's blessing on our search for a new musical director, and we pray for Jocelyn Williams, the parish bookkeeper. The risen Lord calls us to be his witnesses. May our lives help others to see his presence among us. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the world, for those in Gaza, the Ukraine, Haiti, and the rest of the world. Christ showed wounded hands and feet to his unbelieving apostles. May we see the risen one in all the wounded of our world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all who are struggling, sick or in need. For Alf, the Calendar family, for Ed, Frida, Mark, Nancy, Nicole, Ray, Roy and Wendy, Ruth, Scott, Ted, Colleen, David, Johnny, Joshua, Corinne, Liz, Richard, Suzanne, and Comfort, and for any others known to you.
For Mary Beth.
For our parish nurse and visiting teams, for all in the healing profession, that the risen Christ will brighten their lives and give them courage. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us remember our dead, especially Alberta Matthews, and for all our loved ones, and for any others known to you.
For Sandy.
Believing that they are resurrected into your kingdom, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May God our Father, who raised Jesus from the dead, send his Spirit into our hearts and make us witnesses in the world. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. God welcomes us sinners and invites us to God's table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Well, we are so delighted that you can be with us online. As Jesus says, share the good news. Why not share the good news with those we love? So we'd like to invite you to subscribe to our Holy Trinity Guildwood YouTube channel. And then why not pass on the news in your socials? Pass it on your Facebook, your Instagram, something in TikTok, and let other people know about God's message of forgiveness and love. And then we're even more delighted when people are in person, where we can taste, touch, and see. It is good that you are here. Well, we were talking about new leaders and new ideas, and one of Shirley's wonderful ideas was the birthday club, which is back. So the idea is really simple. Holy Trinity loves an excuse to get together, have a good time, and eat and drink. So, if you have had a birthday in the last 4 months, January, February, March, April, we're, for those that would like, we're going to go out for a birthday lunch after this service on April the 28th. So, the wrong date is in the announcement here, on April the 28th. And then, in other times, I've known people who didn't have a birthday to come along as well. There's always room. It's just an excuse to love each other and to go out, have some food, some fellowship. So that's the birthday club, and that is April the 28th, two Sundays from now. Also, I'm really looking forward to our, the pun is, May the 4th be with you. It's really, in church language, we call it a time and talent night. Again, we get together with food and some wine and some desserts, and we have a great evening of fun and fellowship. And then people have offered various gifts. When you take a look, some people have said, oh, would you like to have a cottage weekend in Muskoka? Or would you like to have a gourmet meal made by a chef? Or would you like your gardening done? And you, in the midst of the evening, have a chance to bid on these wonderful treasures. So we hope you could come. Our seating capacity is 96, and my understanding is that we are in the 90s. So if you'd like to come, we would like you to come, but buy a ticket now. I don't know. Do we have any ticket sellers here at this point? Shirley, so speak to Shirley. So we're going to have a full house for sure. And it'll be a great fun evening. And then in the end, we'll use those funds to help keep the ministry of the Holy Trinity alive and well and vital. There's an article on stewardship from Peter Mrazek, and in the middle of it, he talks about the importance of legacy giving. I want to call, we were praying for about Berta Matthews, one of our saints whose DNA, the Matthews family and Alberta's, is deep, deep in this parish. My earliest memories are doing Christmas Eve and then going to Alberta's for the party, the Christmas Eve party. It's just one of my founding memories of this parish. And again, it's you can bless the church not only while you're here, but again, that offer to maybe you'd like to consider the gift of the church in your will or in a legacy gift, as we heard last Sunday. It is a legacy gift that saved our church during the pandemic. So God bless those saints that not only care for us in their life, but in their death. We thank you for your generosity. It is what keeps Holy Trinity alive, strong, and well. Thank you for your goodness. Touch and sound in you, and you in me. Lord, your summons echoes true in you, but call my name. Let me turn and follow you, and never be the same. In the company I'll go, where your love and footsteps show. Thus I'll move and live and grow in you and you in me. Lord, we move and live and grow in you, and we bring from all that you bless us with these gifts, the gifts of our time, our talent, our treasure. Bless us. In your kingdom, you have made us free from sin. And accept all we offer you this day, and strengthen us in the hope of the new life you have given us, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. We give you thanks and praise for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us eternal life. Therefore, joining our voices with the whole company of heaven, we sing our joyful hymn of praise to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you have made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new. And bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your children. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior taught us, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Lord, we died with you on the cross. Now we are raised to new life. We were buried in your tomb. Now we share in your resurrection. Live in us that we may live in you. The gifts of God for you, the children of God.
Thank you.
many. Standing, let us pray. Author of life divine, in the breaking of bread we know the risen Lord. Feed us always in these mysteries, that we may show your love and forgiveness, your glory to all the world. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. I'm going to invite the kids to come forward. There we go. And at the end, Richard, well, I think Richard is going to be our most eager lay assistant ever. So we're just training him in the early days. Yeah. So what did you do in church school?
When Jesus...
Big boy said you go. We all...
When Jesus came to life and came down, his disciples saw him and were amazed and surprised. And they prepared food for him.
Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else want to say something? Mackenzie?
So in the beginning of the story, basically when Jesus was came back to life, these two people, I forget their names, but they were talking about Jesus and they were like, you must have not known the bad news. And then he was so confused because he's like, I'm right here. I'm Jesus. And then the two guys were very confused.
Yeah. So one of the ways Jesus kind of eliminates that confusion is he invites them to what? He invites them to touch and to see. But how today do we touch and see Jesus? Oh, well, we're going for advance now. Go for it, Mackenzie.
Well, how you could see that he was real and he wasn't a ghost is because he had the nail marks in his hand where they nailed him into the cross.
Right. And how do we today touch and see Jesus? Not 2,000 years ago. You're right. You gave a very good answer. They went, oh, this is really the Jesus that was crucified. We can see the nail marks. But how? Adugo?
We know Jesus that's in our house.
Oh, I want to hear this again.
We know that Jesus is in our hearts.
In our hearts. So, Adugo, that you guys have given me such great feedback.
How do we know that Jesus is in our hearts? What do we do each week?
We light the candle to show that Jesus is with us.
Wow. So I'm going to tell you a story about that. So there's a granddad or a papa, and he's with his granddaughter, and they are flying a kite. And as they're flying the kite, and the granddad has the kite in his hands, some clouds come over. And this little girl should be really young, a bit older than Carrie Anna. So she's maybe 4. She says, Papa, do you think a thief has stolen that kite away? And Papa says, no, the kite is still there on the string. And she says, Papa, how do you know that the kite is still there? You can't see it. It's like it's gone. And he says, I can feel the kite tugging on the string. That's what Adugo is saying. We can feel the risen Christ tugging on our hearts. And that's how we know he's alive and risen.
Like when we help people, it's very happy for Jesus and God.
Yes, and when we help people, Adugo says, it is very happy for Jesus and God, because then we see Jesus in each other, loving us through other people, loving us through our mommy and daddy, loving us through our sister, loving us through our brother, and you loving them.
And various orders and fraternities, like the St. John of God Hospitality Brothers, they help the poor, and that's very nice for them to help, because they see the person of Christ in everyone they meet, and especially they are devoted to the Good Shepherd, which we celebrate next Sunday.
And Rogelio is giving a trailer. Next Sunday we'll celebrate Jesus as Good Shepherd.
And I have one thing. So yeah. Today we are a smaller group because many in our group, they are struggling with this virus stuff going around. So for the Foblers, for the One Buns, for the Amapariolas, for Hanan. Yeah, we have a few people who just aren't feeling well today,
so
of our young next generation.
Prayers.
So we are missing you, and we hope you feel better, and we look forward to seeing you next week.
And lastly, let me say thank you. Brian is away on the Dominican Republic. It takes many people to make a service, but Nene, all by herself, our AVU crew. We're in an interim music period, and yet our angel of mercy, Marilyn, keeps on. And then to thank our readers and our altar guild. It takes many people to make a service come together. Thank you for your gifts. We'll have our closing hymn. Yeah. Striving and our sin. Come and journey, come and
journey with the Savior who has come. We are all God's sons and daughters. In the Spirit we are one. Come and journey outward, telling others all is made.
Lord of the empty tomb, the conqueror of gloom, come to you. The Lord in the garden walking, the Lord with Mary talking, come to you. The Lord in the upper room dispelling fear and doom, come to you. The Lord on the road to Emmaus giving hope to Thomas, come to you. The Lord appearing on the shore, giving us life forevermore, come to you. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Followers of Jesus, inspired by the Holy Spirit, serve the world with love and forgiveness. Serve the world God loves. Alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia.